Okay, good afternoon. Thanks a lot, Maria, for your introduction. And it's a pleasure to be part of this series of seminars of the European Astrobiology Institute of Academic Courses. And today we'll talk about the problem of how can we focus the definition of habitability, especially for exoplanets, and with the aid of climate models. In the end of this talk, I also will discuss the possibility of expanding the very definition of habitability to the case of non-terrestrial life. So, as we know, the main goal of the astrobiological research today is to look for a remote detection of atmospheric biosignatures in exoplanets. And detecting such biosignatures in the thin atmospheres of habitable planets is extremely challenging. And this will require intensive observations performed with the most competitive astronomical facilities, such as the James Webb Space Telescope, or on ground, also the ESO facility, the European Extremely Large Telescope, and just to mention a few instruments. But in any case, it's clear that for this type of research, they're quite challenging. And a strategy is required aimed at selecting optimal targets. And the best targets would be planets that do have the capability of hosting life, but in particular, life that is capable of leaving a chemical imprint on the atmosphere. So the habitability criteria should be tailored for a life that is metabolically active and is present on the surface, because on the surface you have the highest chance to leave an imprint on the atmosphere. And also, we need, if you want to discriminate the potential of different planets, different targets, we need quantitative indices of habitability. And so I start my talk talking about habitability. And in the first part, we'll talk of criteria based on terrestrial life, introducing some operational definitions. And that give us the possibility to obtain quantitative estimates of habitability. So if Q is a physical or chemical quantity such that life can only active from the metabolic point of view when Q is within the limits Q1 and Q2, we can, and if we know the surface distribution on the planet of Q as a function of longitude, latitude, and time, we can introduce a habitability function, capital H, which is one when Q is between Q1 and Q2, and is zero otherwise. From this, we can integrate on the planetary surface, so in longitude, in latitude, and also over the orbital period P, and we can obtain a quantitative index of habitability, a small h, in this way. Of course, the choice of the quantity Q is very critical. We know that life is sensitive to variations of several quantities, physical or chemical quantities. In principle, this could be used to establish a quantitative definition of habitability. I will focus on temperature in particular. There are two good reasons to focus on temperature. Well, the first is that the planetary climate and habitability, they undergo severe transitions in different temperature regimes. For instance, when the temperature is very low, the planet can undergo a snowball transition, so it is fully ice. And when it is too hot, you know, if you have studied the habitable zone concept, you know that the planet would undergo a transition to a runaway greenhouse. And so, but the second good reason is that temperature also plays an essential role in the regulation of life processes. So Okay. If we focus on temperature, and we take as an example a planet where we have we know the temperature distribution of the surface, we average the temperature in longitude, and so we have only a dependence on latitude. And in this case, we have the habitability function capital H and the habitability index small h will have this form that you can see in these equations, in these very simple equations. And the temperature distribution T as a function of phi and T can be estimated with the seasonal latitudinal climate models that we see in a few slides. And the point here, the critical point, of course, is to define temperature limits. And we start from, of course, as it's usually done in studies of habitability, we use the terrestrial life as a guideline. And the liquid water criterion is the typical example. And so the capital H function would be one when the surface temperature is within the limits of liquid water, so between the melting point of ice and the boiling point of water. And of course, these limits depend also on the surface pressure. And so this would give the possibility of establishing habitability index just based on the liquid water criterion. But I will show also some unconventional example based on biological thermal limits. And this is, you can find details on this paper. And basically in this case, what we do is to look for which are the thermal limits of terrestrial life when you focus on life that have an active metabolism and capability of reproduction. We want an active metabolism, otherwise we will not have a chemical imprint in the atmosphere, okay? And also capability of reproduction, otherwise you wouldn't have the persistence of life in the long term on the planet. And so when you focus on the type of life, and in particular to the photosynthetic production of oxygen, which is performed by plants and most cyanobacteria, and on multicellular organisms that such as plants, invertebrates, and ectothermic vertebrates, you will find, and there is a review by Clark in 2014, you will find that typically the typical range in this case is quite limited, is between 0 Celsius and 50 Celsius. And so this is a possible way of setting biological limits of life. And the advantage of this particular choice is that it would maximize the probability of detecting atmospheric biosignatures, because it's focused on life with active metabolism, and in particular for the metabolism, the production of oxygen, these limits are based on terrestrial life. They are valid. But there is another important advantage for climate calculations. If we limit the upper temperature to 50 Celsius, in practice, we avoid the situation in which the planet undergoes a runaway greenhouse instability. And so this is also an important point that simplifies the calculations of habitability with climate models. And so just to close this part on the operational definitions of habitability, of course, clearly the choice of the limits T1 and T2 is, of course, is very questionable, okay? However, the point here that I want to make is that once we have a model of the surface temperature distribution, it is really straightforward to calculate several indices of habitability. You can pick up other temperatures that you like in principle. And very fast way, you can calculate different indices that you best like for different reasons. So actually, the most difficult task of this operational definition is estimating the surface temperature distribution of the planet. And this can be done with the aid of climate models. So here I start talking about climate models, in particular for the applications to exoplanets. And there are two critical points in applying climate models. The first is that, in particular for exoplanets, we know very well that we have a very limited amount of experimental data that can be used to constrain the models. Like we know the stellar spectrum, luminosity, the orbital parameters. So in this way, we know actually the insolation, which is a very important parameter for the climate. But then we have a very few planetary data, at least until we will have good spectra of the planetary atmospheres. And so one critical point is the fact that we have a few data, so we need to parameterize the data that we don't know. So we need to explore a vast range of parameter space. The other critical point, I mean, that's common to any climate model, the intrinsic complexity of the climate system. Just to mention you the problem of the complexity of the climate system, I have taken a couple of slides from my friend and colleague Antonello Provenzale, who is a very well-known climatologist. And so the climate system is characterized by multiple components that you should treat all together in principle. The surface, lithosphere, hydrosphere, the cryosphere, I mean the ices, the atmosphere, biospheres, and so on. So treating all these components is by itself extremely difficult. But then a real problem is the fact that there are multiple feedbacks. And for instance, the most famous are the feedback between temperature and atmospheric water vapor, temperature, clouds, albedo, ice and albedo, vegetation, and albedo, vegetation and precipitation, the CO2 and the acidity of the oceans. In principle, these feedbacks that can be included in climate models, but they become more and more complex. And in studies of exoplanets habitability, there is in practice a hierarchy of climate models that have been used. And here I have listed the basic types. We have, for instance, models, one-dimensional models that study a single atmospheric column, and these have been used in the definition of the classic habitable zone. They are mostly used in these type of models. Then we have energy balance models. I will show you some examples now, and which are typically one-dimensional, but one-dimensional in the sense of the latitude, okay? Instead, the first example that I made above is one dimension in the sense of the vertical distribution in the single atmospheric column. But we can have also upgraded energy balance models that have one dimension in latitude and one dimension in the vertical dimension. So they are kind of 2D. Then you have 3D models of intermediate complexity. And then you have the state of the art 3D general circulation models, GCMs. And of course, these are the most complex one. But as I will show you, they are not necessarily best ones to study exoplanets in general. How can we test these models? Well, for some of these models, we can use solar system rocky planets or the paleoclimate of the Earth to provide validation tests. But this type of test, they are actually very limited compared to the parameter space that we need to sample to characterize exoplanets. So in practice we are kind of forced to test models comparing the using models of higher complexity to provide a benchmark to validate models of lower complexity. And so which models are more convenient? Of course, in principle, we would like to use the most realistic 3D models, global circulation models, but they are extremely CPU time consuming, and they are appropriate to study well characterized planets. You know, I mean, if you don't know, for instance, the exact geography, distribution of the continents and of the oceans and many other characterizations of the planet, it doesn't make sense to run a 3D model, because you must invent all of these features. And it takes a lot of CPU time to make a model of something that actually you don't know the input parameters. And there are, of course, it's very interesting to use models of lower complexity, like energy balance models. They are less realistic, but they are fast. And they are appropriate to explore the vast range of parameters that are not characterized from the observational point of view. And also, you know, these models of lower complexity are interested because it's easier, thanks to their flexibility, they're easier. It is easier to single out the impact of a specific climate factor. No, you can easily switch off or switch on different parameters and study the impact of different climate factors. So here is an example of what is an energy balance model. And in particular, it's appropriate when you can average the longitudinal quantities. And in this case, it makes sense as long as the rotational period is much shorter than the orbital period. And so we are not interested in the day-night temperature variations. We have an average of day-night temperature, but we at least we have the temperature distribution in latitude. And the planet surface is divided in latitude strips. In each strip, we calculate the energy balance, and we have the outgoing radiation. And I term is the outgoing long wavelength radiation. A capital A is the top of the atmosphere albedo of the planet. And then you have the insulation term, S, a diffusion term, which basically deals with the transport or the meridional transport of heat along the planetary surface. And then we have a thermal capacity of the surface. And so this type of model can run very fastly. And based on this model, we have produced with our group in Trieste a model which is called ESTM, and is a sort of upgraded 2D energy balance model tailored for Earth-like planets. And this allows us to perform a fast exploration of many parameters that impact the climate, such as surface pressure, atmospheric composition, gravity, radius, rotation rate, obliquity, and idealized geography. The point is that you produce a surface temperature distribution, T, as a function of latitude and time. And from this, you apply these operational definitions of habitability, and you can find some habitability index, which is by construction normalized between 0 and 1. So some of the parameters that of the quantities that go inside the equation, they can be calculated exactly. For instance, the insulation, it's based on astronomical terms, and we can also calculate the evolution of the stellar luminosity with the stellar evolutionary tracks. And but then there are another important term is the diffusion term, which is in this equation is treated in a very naive way, which is because basically it's the equation of heat diffusion. But what we did in 2015 is to model this D, the term D, in terms of the real physics of the atmosphere, and so the real flux that is going from the equator to the poles. And so using, we made some calibrations based on models of a higher complexity, and we ended up using, introducing dependence of this term T of several quantities of the planet, right? The radius, surface pressure, gravity. And so this was, in our opinion, a great improvement for this type of model. And then an important upgrade with respect to classic EBMs is the fact that we treat the radiative transfer in single columns. We calculate the outgoing long wavelength radiation, which is the thermal emission, and the top of the atmosphere albedo, using is tabulated for a given set of planetary and atmospheric properties. And this is, these calculations are actually quite tough calculations, and they require a lot of time. But what we do is to tabulate these quantities as a function of the set of parameters of the planet we are interested. So once we have tabulated these quantities as a function of surface temperature, we can plug in this to the to our model, and in this way we obtain a very fast calculation of the climate, of the surface temperature. Recently we have upgraded these radiative transfer calculations. You can find in AstroPH the public that has just been accepted for Astrophysical Journal. Here you have some examples of comparisons of outgoing long wavelength radiation in the left panel and top of atmosphere albedo in the left and right panel, compared with between different models of radiative transfer. And I don't have time to go in this, but this is a very tough part of our work, and we are quite glad that we finally managed to introduce this part, a large flexibility, and to perform this type of calculations. And concerning the other terms of the equation, like the thermal capacity of the surface albedo, we have also recently performed a lot of improvements. And so we are in the position to have a better definition of the albedo of the clouds, the coverage of ice versus temperature, the cloud albedo versus the stellar zenith distance. And so with these improvements, we are in the position to perform calculations, to explore a range of parameters. Let me show you just very basic examples of what we can do. Basically, we can vary one parameter at a time and repeat the climate calculations, which take a few minutes once the radiative transfer tables have been set for that particular planet. And so for here you can see some examples of surface temperature distributions obtained by varying the insulation in the upper two panels, vary the insulation between 0.9, the current insulation of the Earth, to 1.1 times the insulation. The change in surface temperature is dramatic just for using this change of 10%. Below you can see a change between surface pressure between 0.5 bar and 4 bars. Also in this case, the change of surface temperature is quite strong. And so we can also change the rotation period. We can change the axis obliquity. I do not have time now to explain this the impact, how these particular changes are affecting the planet. But if you want to make some questions, I'm glad to answer you. But basically, the important thing to notice here is that, for instance, rotation period, axis obliquity, there's information that we do not have for the planet, but they affect the climate, the temperature, and so the climate and habitability. And it's important to have the possibility to sample these quantities in order to investigate habitability. So we can make some exploration of habitability, vary all these parameters. If you want to have fun, you can go to this website. We have put a first sample of simulations, results of simulations. We plan, which are based on the previous version of the ESTM. We plan to upgrade this catalog with the new version. We can study individual exoplanets, like in this paper. And in this case, for the individual exoplanet, we don't know many parameters. So once again, we can change imagine the different planetary structure, compositions, atmospheric pressure, and perform studies of habitability. And in this case, in the right panel at the bottom, you can see also we can change the luminosity of the star in the course of its of stellar evolution and see how it would impact the habitability. We can also make statistical studies of habitability. And for instance, we have investigated the bistability of the climate, which is a very, very well-known phenomenon, which is based on the fact that depending on the initial temperature of the planet, you can end up in two different climate solutions. And of course, this would affect the habitability of the planet, that could go either in a snowball state or a warm state. And this, to make other examples, we can investigate habitability as a function of insulation, as you can see here, as in normal habitable zones. But in the vertical axis, you can see here the another quantity, which is the atmospheric columnar mass, which in hydrostatic equilibrium is nothing else than P over G. Surface pressure divided by the gravity, surface gravity acceleration. And in this way, we can investigate how the habitable zone changing the composition, the atmospheric composition of the planet, changing many other parameters. And the interesting thing that in this plot, by plotting the atmospheric columnar mass, in the lower part of the habitable zone, we know that the column density of the atmosphere is very small, and so high energy particles are arriving on the surface of the planet and making a biological damage. So it's interesting because we have a hint of how the habitable zone can also affect the different physical quantities that affect the change the habitability. The final goal of this work that we're doing is to connect the indices of habitability with the detectability of the atmospheric biosignatures. We know that, of course, the possibility of detecting a biosignature through a transmission on spectroscopy during a primary transit. Of course, that probability increases with the molecular column density that is sampled by the line of sight. And this column density is a function of the atmospheric structure, atmospheric composition, physical properties. But the interesting thing is that once you have a model for the climate and habitability, so you have a model also of the atmosphere, you can plug in this model of the atmosphere to calculate which would be the columnar, the molecular column density that in principle could be observable. So this, I think, is an important goal of our, let's say, strategy, because we will link the possibility of having habitable planets and but planets for which we can indeed detect atmospheric features. And thanks to the fact that this type of model, a climate model, is very flexible, we can also introduce easily some very simple idealized feedbacks, like the vegetation feedbacks. And we are in preparation. We have in preparation some work of this type, where we, for instance, the vegetation is becomes darker than bare surface of the continents. And of course, so there is a feedback between vegetation and albedo. And this is called the Charney mechanism. And this is an example of feedback that you can simply put inside this type of this simple type of model. So, okay, this was the first part. And the second part is much, much shorter. And concerns the possibility to answer to the question, can we generalize the criteria of habitability, which are based on terrestrial life? And what I will tell you shortly in the next few slides is based on a paper that you can find published. Here you can see the reference. So let's go on fastly in this type of work. So how can we broaden the definition of habitability? I think the more conservative way of doing this is to consider terrestrial life as a special case or a more universal phenomenon. And in this way, perhaps we can find some universal criteria of habitability, whereby universal, I mean, valid for any type of biochemistry that does include terrestrial life as a special case or of a more universal chemical phenomenon. And to proceed in this type of work, it's convenient to focus only on the molecular level of life processes. This because the molecular level is governed by the laws of physics and chemistry, which are universal. Also, the molecular level is where life may emerge from spontaneous chemical pathways. You know, if you, instead of staying at the molecular level, you go to the higher level functions of biology, those particular functions are the result a lot of biological evolution. And so they are probably could be particular of terrestrial life. But when you stay at the molecular level, I mean, molecules must seem the interaction between molecules, the chemical forces, they must obey to the general laws of physics and chemistry. And so the next step is to focus on life, which is, let's say, a generalization of terrestrial life could be life to be considered as an active process, which is sustained by specialized molecules that must interact with each other, must undergo replication. And basically the idea is, if we assume that generalized life as life sustained by genetic and catalytic molecules, of course, this is a generalization of terrestrial life, but it's more general because these molecules may be different from the terrestrial ones, okay? RNA, DNA, and proteins could be just a special case of a more general molecular set. So there are some universal requirements for these molecules. First of all, they must have long atomic chains. You know, a large number of atoms is required for storing the genetic information, which is a large amount of information. Also, you need long chains to generate a variety of 3D conformations, which are essential if you want to have molecules that act as catalysts. The catalysis is induced also by the shape of the molecule. And these molecules must undergo intermolecular interactions. And the interactions must be non-invasive, non-destructive. This interaction should not destroy the atomic chains. And also intramolecular interactions. And for instance, the folding of chains is required to attain a variety of 3D conformations, which allow to build up a variety of shapes and functions in catalytic molecules. So among all chemical bonds and forces that we know that exist in the universe, hydrogen bonds have unique properties that make them necessary for this type of intramolecular and intermolecular interactions in life processes. Hydrogen bonds are weak and they are directional. Weakness is essential to preserve the atomic chains when during intermolecular or intramolecular interactions. The directionality of the chemical forces is essential for intermolecular recognition and also for pairing of atomic chains. So, and hydrogen bonds also have important unique properties. They are basically tunable in the sense their strength varies according to the environment, molecular environment. And also they can provide a range of strengths that can be required to play both intermolecular, intramolecular roles, and a lot of flexibility for this type of weak directional interactions. Another unique property is the fact that with hydrogen bonds, you can have a transfer of protons and through quantum tunneling. And this effect is really important because proton transfers are fundamental for in the whole acid-base chemistry. So here in this sketch, I have summarized the properties of hydrogen bonds. Basically, you have a hydrogen atom, which is covalently bonded with an atom X, and which has a higher electronegativity, and so it is attracting the electron of the hydrogen, and it's the proton of the hydrogen is to some extent naked, and there is an excess of positive charge. On the other part of this bond, there is an electron lone pair, with an excess of negative charge. And you could have these pairs of in oxygen or nitrogen, carbon. And so the interesting thing is that there are only a few cosmically abundant elements that have a net electronegativity suitable to form hydrogen bonds. In this plot, I have plotted the cosmic abundance of elements in the vertical axis, and in the horizontal axis, you can see the electronegativity. The dashed line is the electronegativity of hydrogen. Only the elements to the right side of this plot can form hydrogen bonds. And which, as I told you, are really essential for life processes. And so let's see which could be the viable chemistries of life with metabolic and catalytic molecules. Based on these arguments, we expect the prebiotic chemistry pathways will naturally select oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, and perhaps some sulfur as the major actors in the sites, active sites of the genetic catalytic molecules. Other atoms such as silicon, they can be incorporated in life for structural roles as it happens also in terrestrial life, but not in the active sites of the genetic or catalytic molecules. So the so-called Chon biochemistry is favored over alternative hypothetical biochemistries like the ones based on silicon that have been invoked sometimes. And what about water in life, the molecular medium of life? Life processes must take place in a molecular medium that allows the mobility and interaction of the biomolecules. And so, but if the medium can provide a network of hydrogen bonds, there are really important, crucial advantages. You can have directional interactions between the medium and the biomolecules, proton transfers, cooperative effects. You can have the support of the hydrophobic effect, which is essential for the spontaneous forming of structures, molecular biological structure. And so which molecules have this possibility of forming hydrogen bonds? Here I have put the three most cosmically abundant molecules. which is water, ammonia, and methane. And in these columns of the table, you can see the possibility of giving being donors of hydrogen bonds or acceptors of hydrogen bonds. You see that methane has four donors, but zero acceptors does. So the methane molecules, they cannot form hydrogen bonds between them. Ammonia has three donors and one acceptor. So yes, ammonia can form a network of hydrogen bonds, but basically is one-dimensional network. Water has two donors and two acceptors. So it is a special feature that allows water to form a 3D network of hydrogen bonds. So based on this consideration, the life based on genetic and catalytic molecules strongly favors the biochemistry based on carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, and water over alternative biochemistries. So this means that the liquid water criterion of habitability is probably relevant to any form of life sustained by genetic catalytic molecules, not only to terrestrial life. So sorry for being so fast and long. And I basically finished, and I'm the conclusions is that I hope I have convinced you that modeling the habitability and the detectability of atmospheric biosignatures is a priority of exoplanet research, but is very challenging. To accomplish this goal, we must tailor climate models for exoplanets. We must explore the impact of multiple climate factors on habitability, to build up a kind of generalized habitable zone. And also we must face the challenge of defining criteria of habitability, which are not simply based on terrestrial life, but at least we make an effort to generalize the concept. And in the future, I think we should also consider the conditions, not only the conditions of habitability, but also the conditions that allow life to emerge from the prebiotic world. And this is a completely different story. And with this, I really thank you again. Thank you for your attention. I left on this slide the name of the collaborators of our group. Mostly are from Trieste, but we have also people, two climatologists from Torino and Pisa. And so thanks again, and I'm ready to take your questions.